Hi, and good morning, and welcome to the 18th meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2024. Apologies for that delay. We have apologies from Stephanie Callaghan, MSP, this morning. Our first agenda item is an evidence session on pre-budget scrutiny of the university and colleges sector for the 2025-2026 budget, and the first session will focus on college funding. So can I welcome our first panel, and thank you very much for joining us and for your written submissions ahead of the meeting. We have Mark McPherson, Audit Director, Audit Scotland, thank you, and David Belsey, Assistant Secretary from EIS FILA. Good morning, gentlemen. We're going to move straight to members' questions, and the first question is from my colleague Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Thank you for the information you've submitted in advance of the session this morning. My first question is about the fact that over recent years there's been multiple reports that have called for the Scottish Government to set out a vision for colleges to help with the progress towards long-term financial stability, sustainability. Can I ask the panel what their view is on the assessment that can be made of how the Scottish Government's progress towards this has gone so far?
Yes, Mark.
Yeah, I mean, we haven't done any detailed work on the specifics of the individual reviews, but you'll know from the report that we produced, as well as the evidence that we gave to the Public Audit Committee, that we believe that there is a need to increase the pace around some of these changes. We know that the Minister and the Government have made statements about this. We know that work is ongoing, but I think the college sector and probably the wider education sector is waiting for some clearer steer on what these changes might mean for them.
Thank you.
Yes, the Scottish Government has commissioned some reports, the Withers Review, the Cumberford-Little report. You've also got it's also instructed the Funding Council to carry out some reviews, and the Funding Council has published some reviews on really moving the college sector into a tertiary sector. I've got to say, from the IS perspective, we've not been too impressed with these reviews. There seems to be a push to reframe the college sector as being part of a vehicle that delivers training for businesses, and as opposed to vehicles for delivering training and education opportunities for young people and communities. And I think the hope from some of these reviews is that colleges may draw more money in from businesses and from commercialisation and so forth in order to help their sustainability, whereas we would prefer a Scottish Government to invest more money directly within the funding.
Thank you both for that. In commenting on the reforms, the Cabinet Secretary recently said that to respond to them, there's the necessity and opportunities of reform, that they have to minimise the impact on frontline allocations for learning and teaching and support for students. So can I ask the panel, what do you think the impact on learning, teaching and support has been of the recent budget settlement?
Well, I'm very clear that there is a cut in activity in colleges, and that there are fewer lecturers and support staff as a result of those cuts. And, you know, last year, for example, the Scottish Government the Scottish Funding Council removed the sort of ability to claw back funding if the activity dropped by 10%. Now, what that means is it gives an invitation to some colleges to drop activity by 10% without any comeback from the Funding Council. And 10% less activity means 10% less staff. It means fewer staff. It means fewer students or students having to travel further to access the course they need to carry out.
And have you seen a pattern in that activity that's been dropped?
Well, I think different colleges have dealt with the difficult funding environment in different ways and with varying degrees of success.
One of the things that came across in the submissions was the reduction in students enrolling for hires, for Nat 5s, for Nat 4s, NC down, HNCs are down, SVQs are down. Do you know why that is, and what does it tell us about the impact on learning and teaching?
Well, I think that I think regionalisation has meant that there are fewer colleges, and there are fewer physical locations offering courses. And therefore, before in Fifew I had three colleges offering similar provision in some ways, now you've got one, and provision would be moved and tightened, particularly as you go up the hierarchy of the credit and qualifications framework towards hires, HNCs and HNDs. So that's one issue. The second issue is that the reduction in funding means that you've got colleges have to make difficult decisions as to which courses are viable and not viable. So stonemasonry, for example, has gone from Edinburgh. You've also got, by getting rid of staff, experienced staff, you're also losing a skills base there that makes some courses less attractive. I think that there are, you know, those are the realities of long-term realities of a sustained real terms cut in FE funding, and also the consequences of the regionalisation programme. And these programmes, these effects, are long-running. They've come in from a long time, you know, around 10 years. And that's why we're seeing long-term trends of fewer qualifications being taken.
And can I ask one final question, Convener? Thank you. Have you noticed any impact on widening access and the experience of students from the poorest backgrounds?
I think colleges are, much of their role is focused on communities, their location in communities, and their role is to give many people a second chance who didn't do well in school or who have come back into education from the workforce or have a change of circumstances and a mindset possibly when they are young people or adults. And so colleges by definition draw in more people from poorer communities, from disadvantaged backgrounds, from SAMD 20. And the college sector has a greater number of SAMD students, twice the proportion than the university sector. So so any cut in provision to the college sector automatically disproportionately affects working class communities, and this affects people that otherwise may not be able to get into the education train to move on to other qualifications or for upskilling their work. So I can't directly give you evidence around the direct impact on SAMD 20, but it's you know, the whole effect of colleges is to disproportionately affect working class communities. And I would also say that the I think one of the either the SFC or audit committee in the past have said that one of the big hits on college provision after the cut round of cuts that came in about 2011-12 was on young women attending colleges and people with caring responsibilities. So they've been disproportionately hit in the past.
Thank you.
Sorry, speaking in the mic wasn't on. Thank you very much. Ben McPherson, can I come to yourself now?
Thank you, Convener. Thank you both for your time. So building on both what's already been asked and what's been said, I wondered if you could elaborate further on the post-school reform agenda and how can it, in your view, help colleges with some of the concerns around financial sustainability this year and potentially going forward. And then also related to a point that was raised earlier, what should be the key considerations for the Scottish Government, the SFC and institutions if and when looking at potentially increasing private sector involvement in the college sector?
Yeah, I don't think I'm in a position to answer the second one. It's not something we've looked at in any detail, but I will say about the first one, obviously, as David has mentioned, there have been a number of reviews and the committee will be well familiar with those. There are opportunities, I think, within those reviews, should they be implemented in the way that was described by those who conducted the reviews. For example, with Withers, the multiple pots of funding that exist within the sector, and if there was scope to rationalise and simplify the range and number of those pots of funding, then perhaps there would be opportunities for some savings and efficiencies within the sector. Equally, Withers obviously recommended the creation of a single funding body, and again, that may lead to some clarity and streamlining of the requirements of colleges, as well as ease of access to the funding. I should say that it's not known whether all those things will make the difference that is needed to re-establish the complete financial sustainability of the sector, but they could help.
I think the first thing to say about Withers is that the EIS and lecturing staff recognise the broad nature and role of the college sector, and that involves engaging with local employers, both public sector such as the NHS and private employers, private companies, in order to engage with their workforces and to bring upskilling and reskilling towards them. And clearly there is a way of drawing in money, funding for that work. I think the problem that we have with Withers is not so much that private sector wider engagement is there, but that it seems to dominate the agenda, and that it moves away from really looking at colleges as means of delivering education to individuals. And it's about the danger of Withers and the Cumberford Little Report is that the college looks around, sees what local employers want, and offers those courses to students. And if a student doesn't want to do a course in shipbuilding, then the student is it doesn't have their needs and their aspirations met. So there needs to be a balance there, and we are in favour of that balance. So yes, there is. We would support efforts to increase commercialisation, but not at the cost of supporting individual and communities. So the other key consideration then around sustainability, I think, to be frank, there's only one way in which colleges are going to be sustainable in the future, and that's if the government provides them with sufficient funding. The reality is that activity is kept at broadly flat, although they're allowed to deliver 10% less. They want staff to be paid more. Electricity, capital costs, all of that is increasing in the real world, and you can't do it without additional funding. So if you wish to have the current footprint of colleges with the current amount of activity, with lecturers delivering high quality, sustained further education, then you need to pay for it. And I think that looking for the private sector to contribute to it helps, but fundamentally the state must pay for it.
Can you say a bit more about what a balance looks like to you? Because I absolutely appreciate your point there, thinking about all the issues you raised earlier about making sure that people can have a second chance, that they can go back to education, that they can retrain. Absolutely appreciate that. I just, as we move into considering Withers and how it's taken forward, I think it'd be helpful to know what a balance looks like. I appreciate you can't be absolutely definitive in that, but more thoughts on it would be interesting.
So Withers and indeed the previous report called the Cumberford Little Report seem to want to merge and bring greater role of business people into colleges And I seem to recall that Withers involves some sort of formal relationship where business people get involved in either advising or steering the decisions around provision. And the whole mood music is moving colleges then to more tertiary sort of aspect, which is almost university-light. And by looking at a shared funding model and that sort of thing. But the reality is that colleges are different to universities. They serve different people. And whilst the best way to get people from many communities into university is through college, because college delivers something unique and different, and something that we should be very proud of in Scotland. But the current mood music and sort of reviews and almost promoting the idea that they serve business is flawed. And I think that we need to talk about more about the individual. What do communities need? What do individuals need? How do individuals fit into this, the pathways, that the learner pathways more effectively, and move away from having business people advising colleges and having an enterprise agency funding a college? You know, that's not the way that really gives the appropriate balance, in our view.
So what is a balance? 50-50, is it? 70-30, what's the balance?
Well, I mean, I would say the majority role of the college is to meet the needs of the individuals concerned.
Okay. So, I mean, I'm trying to think of, I can only frame this in my own constituency, where I have Edinburgh College and it's a fantastic institution, and I appreciate the concerns that many of your members have at Edinburgh College, there's also, you know, huge potential net zero growth in Edinburgh, North and Leith. There's creative industries are expanding, and the college has already got a very strong creative aspect to it. How it can fulfil the demand for skills in net zero, to me these are huge opportunities for my constituents, and the college and the individual and the community would all want to be engaged in that. So that's why I'm interested in the balance, not just for my constituency, but it's relevant more widely.
And I'm sure Edinburgh College is loving the support that we're giving it here. But yes, Carol,
well, I'm being objective.
I know you are, Ben. It's fine. I'd just
be interested in what our balance looks like. But I'm happy to move on if that's... No.
Well, maybe we might come to pick up that thread later on in terms of that balance and some of the things that you're discussing there. Liam, can I come to yourself now, please?
Yes, thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Mark McPherson, you've just heard David Belsley talking about sustainability. The Audit Scotland report from September 2023 said that the Scottish Government and the SFC urgently needed to help colleges become sustainable now. And the following month, the Auditor General said that the viability of the college sector is challenged and a clear plan is needed. So we're now 9 months on from that. Has that assessment changed? Has Audit Scotland's assessment changed that? And is there any evidence of either or and the government and the SFC plan which will make them viable in your view?
Well, I just said not to preempt too much. We are preparing a further output on behalf of the Auditor General for this year. It will be based on the financial year of colleges ending July 2023, so we'll not be bang up to date. We have had some discussions with the Funding Council, and we know that alongside the funding model, they are also engaging with colleges to determine what more can be done to try and support colleges into a sustainable position. But I think at the moment, our view is still that work needs to be done in order to bring the colleges onto a sound financial footing.
David Belsley, your view, and is that work being done?
Well, I don't think there is a plan set out that the Scottish Government has published that sets out how colleges do move forward. But I think, in reality, there is a plan, and the plan is to give them less funding, to allow less activity, to recognise that staff are being lost, to allow pay to be depressed, and you know that is the current strategy in place, and that's why the college sector is in the position that it is in.
Very grateful. Given what you've just said, we brought up the Withers report earlier on, but James Withers referred to colleges as, quote, a burning platform in relation to finance and sustainability. And he said that he feared that there might be a, quote, chaotic reorganisation based on the law of natural selection. David Belsey, do you recognise this risk? If so, what can be done to manage it? And is the government taking that action?
I think to the Scottish Government previously reordered the college sector in the regionalisation programme around 10 years ago. And I think it would be very difficult to see future mergers take place on the basis of natural selection, other than the Highlands and Islands region. I think that is a separate case. I think going forwards, colleges are expensive to run, and they need investment, and they need they need to compete for the best staff, and they play a huge role, which I think Withers acknowledged. And all of that is not going to happen without investment. I personally can't see how any other mergers can take place. You're looking at possibly Lanarkshire with two colleges. You look at a city the size of Glasgow's, it's got three colleges. I can't see any, you can't really have a city the size of Glasgow, the city with one single college. I mean, I think Edinburgh strains with having one single college. And, there are some courses in Edinburgh which are only delivered in one location, which means that people need to travel significant distances across the city to access those courses. I think where my concern around the natural selection, if it was to use the question that you put, Mr. Kerr, is the UHI. And, there already has been one merger there from West Highland, North Highland and Lewes Castle. And then there are clear strains in Shetland College where there are redundancies, Murray College where there are redundancies, Perth College where there are redundancies. And I think that is a cause for concern.
Very grateful, Mark McPherson. Given what you've just heard and obviously what you know about the sector, is there a risk of chaotic reorganisation? And if so, what's been done to mitigate it?
I'm not sure there's an immediate risk of chaotic reorganisation. I will say, just on the mergers point, I mean, any opportunities to create synergies, to make efficiencies, could help some colleges. We've seen that in respect of the intention around UHI North, Western Hebrides, which David has mentioned. It's too early to say whether that has achieved all of the benefits it was intended to do, but that's something we'll be monitoring going forward. I think all of those things, mergers, shared services, synergies, have the potential to help some colleges. I'm not sure they're the answer to the challenges that the sector faces.
Very grateful. Convener.
Thank you. And we're going to go to Willie Rennie, who's joining us online. Thanks.
I'm sorry, I'm not able to be with you this morning. I was interested in just following up on Liam Kerr's questions. It was highlighted by the Audit Scotland that there was four colleges at potential risk of collapse. I would just quite like an update on those four colleges. I understand that you won't be able to name them, but could you give us an indication as to what work's been done? And is their future secure, Mr. Mark McPherson?
I don't know that I can give you a clear answer to all of that. Mr. Rennie, but what I will say is that the Funding Council and its work works closely with colleges, and as you'll have heard from the Public Audit Committee session, it does tend to identify colleges that may be at more significant risk, and at the time that we previously talked about that, that was four colleges. That's a changing picture, so I don't know what the current status is. Funding Council would be able to advise on that, I'm sure, if they have that information. We would stress that that because the Funding Council is working with them, they're at risk, or greater risk. It doesn't mean to say that they're not going to continue in their current form. So much depends on what the individual circumstances are at each of the colleges and what has changed since the last time we looked at this.
Did you get an update in advance of today's meeting about how things were progressing?
Well, we're currently doing work, as I said earlier, which will result in a report later in the year, around about September, mid-September. So we'll be able to comment by that stage.
But you've obviously not got immediate concerns that there, that something dramatic is going to happen between now and then. Otherwise, you would have reported on that, would you?
I'm not aware of anything that presents an immediate risk to an operation of a college, but I wouldn't like to say, because things can change tomorrow, can't they? So that's where we are.
Okay. Anything else,
David,
Mr.
have you got any... Yeah, I just wondered if David's got a view on this, whether he's had any secret intelligence that he can help us with to... give us reassurance that those institutions are okay.
I can offer you no reassurance.
Okay.
Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Rennie. I want to ask about some other funding streams, because the SFC initial allocations have shown that teaching funding has been protected, but other funding streams such as the Flexible Workforce Development Fund, which was worth £10 million in the last year, they received that in 2022-23, have been cut. And I was wondering what your thoughts were on what the impact of cutting funds in that way might be on the delivery and the activity within colleges. Do you want to go first, Mark?
And it's not something we've looked at in detail, but we know from the assessment, I think the Scottish Government undertook that the Flexible Workforce Development Fund was an effect, was considered to be an effective means of encouraging people into work and to improve skills. So that would, if that was no longer to continue, it will place extra pressure on colleges, I guess, to meet that same need in a different way. So that's probably as much as I can say about it at this stage.
Yes. Do you have anything, David?
I think the £10 million cut is to obviously linked directly to supporting workers, and I think that's a key role of colleges. And it's unfortunate that it has been cut. The teaching fund being kept the same, or teaching
being protected,
kept,
I think.
Yeah, protected in cash terms, I think is misleading in the sense that it doesn't protect the amount of activity. It doesn't protect the amount of staff that deliver that activity. There are cuts happening in colleges now. There are staff who are facing their centres or their courses being closed down. So, and that is a concern, because it means that fewer students can get to do the course that they need to do or want to do.
Okay. Thank you. Pam, Duncan Glancy, sorry, I was about to just call you Pam.
That's okay. Thank you, Convener. I want to ask specifically about the student support budget, if that's okay. It looks like that's dropped by about £12 million from the Scottish Funding Council, and the justification for that is because what they've said is the allocation for each college will cover at least what was spent last year, therefore demand has dropped. Is that your experience, David Belsey, of your members and what your members are telling you? Do students need less support now?
I can't answer that question directly in the sense of no one has said that to me in recent months, so I can't give you an answer there. But it does seem intuitive that students need as much support as they can in these times.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Can we come back to Ben McPherson now, please?
Thank you, Convener. It relates to where I was finishing off in the last question session, which, you know, what growth areas might the Scottish Government and others want to focus on when looking at where colleges can have the biggest economic impact in the period ahead?
I think it's a bit unfortunate that Mary Spowage isn't able to join us today, because I feel like she'd be much better placed to do that. I think it's clearly for the government, working with the Funding Council and individual colleges, to determine what is right for the distribution and the creation of learning, and what impact that might have on the wider economy. And I think really you need to look to the relationships that colleges have with their local communities and build from there.
Yeah, I think colleges offer fantastic education and training opportunities to pupils, many of whom access colleges, to young people and to adults of all ages. And delivering an educated cohort of people in of itself generates skills for the economy. And I think the paper that Mary has submitted and the report and so forth sets that out very clearly. To what extent then, we've been saying the whole time that the role of colleges is a balance between supporting and investing in individuals so that they can have that positive economic impact, and then supporting companies and organisations and employers directly to also have to grow their skills, their businesses, their services. Now, should colleges be focused on economic impact? No, not in our view, but they should. But it should be a focus, and working with employers is a big part of that. So colleges need to remain up to date with the latest trends, technology, the ways in which services are delivered. And there's a huge engagement there, and experience and skills built up with lecturers who engage in their fields with organisations and business and so forth. And that needs to continue. We're all for that. But that doesn't mean to say that colleges should be limited to give what local employers want. So I would say economic impact and working with businesses and local organisations is important, but it's not the most important thing that colleges do.
And the most important thing colleges do is?
Is meeting the needs of individuals. So an individual wants to go to university to study X, or somebody wants to become a stonemason, somebody wants to go and work in healthcare, somebody wants to go and to be a hairdresser, then that college needs to provide the course to meet their aspirations. And that person can become a competent learner, and it can open doors to a range of destinations. And colleges provide the best way of doing that for a large cohort of society, especially those from poorer backgrounds.
Thank you for setting that out.
Okay, Michelle Thompson.
Good morning. I wanted to talk about infrastructure. Now, we know that we've had a few considerations around that. Obviously, Audit Scotland yourself, you've referenced it in a recent report. The Scottish Funding Council recently updated their own plans. And we had hoped that the Scottish Government would be able to provide an updated infrastructure investment plan, but that's been delayed by the UK civil service because of the UK general election. So it's a slightly different picture. Also, we know that the cuts to capital expenditure forecast over the next 5 years are for a cut of 20%. In real terms, and Audit Scotland, Mark, I know in your report you've referenced the increase for capital expenditure from the Scottish Government that we have evidence of over recent years, i.e. year-end 2022 and year to 2023 and year-end 2023 to 2024. So within that picture, what I wanted to get from you both was, what reflections do you have on where we are with the real need to deliver a sustainable college estate? And so perhaps I could come to yourself, Mark, first.
Sure.
I think we've made quite clear that there are obviously pressures coming to bear on the college estate. The Funding Council has been doing a lot of work with colleges, has set out an investment strategy. I think we are still waiting on an updated estate condition survey from the Funding Council, and that will clearly indicate the scale of the challenge. And inevitably, though, I think that the funding pressures, not just in the college sector but across the public sector in Scotland, means that there will be some means of prioritisation required, and it's unlikely that all of those needs will be met.
Yeah, and I think we could all agree with that. So I suppose what I want to flush out is, given that, I mean, obviously things may change after the general election and any new incoming government may move away from the 20% real terms cut to capital investment, but either way, given the chronic issue with UK public finances, which are an issue across the board, I'd appreciate your thoughts of how infrastructure investment planning that builds into a sustainable college estate, some of the key areas where you think it would be important to plan out, the things that you would draw out from your perspective, accepting and understanding these difficulties?
I think the starting point is, what is your overall plan, vision and purpose for the college sector, if we're sticking with colleges? Then, and from that, you then make a determination about what that means for the infrastructure that's needed to deliver those priorities. And from that, you make your decisions on how you allocate the funding. Yeah. I don't feel that it's any more complicated than that.
And David, reflecting on that as well, I mean, there obviously is a wider impact of these cuts. What's your thinking about how this, you know, from an infrastructure perspective, how we can get to a sustainable college estate, bearing in mind those cuts that I've set out?
I think college estate is important. If you go into some of the colleges we have in Scotland, their buildings are impressive, and you know the learners there will feel valued, and the resources there, you know, deliver that teaching and that learning very effectively. There are challenges to the estate, and I think I don't understand how you can, you know, what does sustainable funding mean? I mean, to my mind, You talk about problems with UK public finances. I see it a little differently. I see it in the sense that the Scottish Government has a budget, and it chooses how to prioritise that budget, and it can choose where to put its money. And we believe that it should put more money in the college sector, in education, and in public services. And that involves building more, investing more. I don't see there is a magic solution of using business. We've got concerns around the private-public partnerships around funding infrastructure, but it did deliver new buildings for a number of learners. So, but ultimately, I think it comes down to priorities, and the Scottish Government hasn't prioritised the estate, and the estate is suffering in places.
So, but that, what you just said, doesn't take any reflection of the fact that there's a projected 20% real terms cut in capital infrastructure. And just to be clear, that the capital budget is given from the UK government to the Scottish government. The Scottish government only has a very limited capacity to increase that budget, extremely limited. So it can't allocate more money on college infrastructure than is available. So in the light of that, what are your reflections? Well, you know, it can't take money from revenue, day-to-day expenditure, and put it on capital. That's illegal. They're not allowed to do that. So they can only spend what they're given, and therefore where you have significant cuts, there is nowhere else for them to go. And therefore, priority calls need to be made in the light of those cuts. And as I pointed out in my opening statement from Audit Scotland, the recent 2 years of real spend from the Scottish Government has shown an increase in capital expenditure. So I suppose I'm trying to understand, within this very real situation, how we can you know, are there any silver bullets to get to the point of delivering a sustainable college estate? Is it as simple as pushing plans out, which I think is what you were alluding to, Mark? We'll have to do less because we've got less.
I think in all of this, there's a fundamental question about what opportunities there might be for genuine reform. And that's something, obviously, the Auditor General and we have talked about in numerous areas. And reform could mean of how services are delivered, and that could extend to how the estate is managed, how it is maintained, how widespread it is. So I think there are lots of options there, but really these are decisions, as you've alluded to and as David has mentioned, about prioritisation of the limited funding that is available. And those are decisions that I think sit outside the remit of Audit Scotland.
And I think we're going to come on to that, convener, aren't we? Thank you.
And can I move now over to this side of the table to Bill Kidd, please?
Thank you, convener. Thank you both for your responses. Can we have a wee look at student numbers in terms of the latest SFC figures show that there's been a move towards part-time study, with full-time education numbers down while overall student numbers are rising. So that obviously means more part-time. What could be the implications of a move towards greater part-time study for the colleges, please?
Probably David in this one, I think.
Okay, just you caught my eye. Okay.
Increased part-time study could be a reflection that students need to work, and therefore they're mixing work with study. It could also mean that people are accessing it at evenings, or they are accessing it on online courses, and that offer more flexibility and to fit in with their lives. It also could lead you know, carers and others with caring responsibilities can access part-time courses more effectively than more easily than full-time courses. So those are the types of students that can access part-time courses and many part-time courses, and the successful completion of the course may then lead to another course or a full-time course in the future. What does it mean for colleges? Well, I guess it means more flexibility in the platforms that that students are taught by and trained by. I also guess it means greater time in terms of, you know, evenings, weekends, online courses, and so forth. And I think it also is a reflection of the difficulty that many students have in affording to be full-time students. So I think those are the issues around part-time students.
Can I ask just, before we come to Mark, just how that affects your members?
So some of our members are involved, have COVID and the pandemic and the lockdown led to a huge growth explosion of online delivery, in which I think brings some students that would otherwise not be able to access in person into the college virtually. I think the UHI obviously leads on a lot of this online engagement too. I think there are pros and cons to it. In terms of part-time courses, the other impact is that they tend to be lower down in the Scottish Credit and Qualifications Framework. So, you know, full-time course, or they take a longer period of time to complete the same course. So that obviously has an impact on completion rates. I would say that the workforce is an incredibly skilled and versatile and flexible workforce, and it has met the differing needs of the colleges, of the students, and of the courses that they need to deliver. So that flexibility is being delivered by staff.
Thank you. Thanks very much for that, because it is interesting. And I was just wondering if Mark has any idea over the any potential economic implications that this might have in the colleges?
No, I mean, it's not something we've looked at in detail. And again, I think it's unfortunate that Mary Spurridge isn't available to attend today. She'd probably be well placed to answer that.
Yes, we are very aware that we are a panel member down. But you spoke there, David, about it being people studying part-time because students have to work. But I'm wondering if we can maybe tip that on its head a little bit. The world is very different now in terms of flexible working and how people learn and live. And do you not think that by having more flexible courses, it might be more beneficial for colleges to get more people to come in and take a sort of more of a positive spin on the opportunities that flexible learning and courses offer?
Well, forgive me, I was trying to be positive. Okay. and saying that the flexible, the access and the way in which college lecturers and colleges have worked to deliver more flexible courses is a good thing.
Yeah, that's all right. That's okay. Audit Scotland's 2023 report stated that further staffing reductions could severely erode colleges' ability to deliver a viable curriculum. And you've spoken about that almost bits today already, David. The SFC has said that 21% of staff could potentially be removed from the sector by 2025-26. So what assessment have you made of the current staffing situation, and what action do you think the Scottish Government and the Scottish Funding Council have to take to really help colleges in that regard? If we'd like to go first on that one.
I think that the inevitable consequence of increased budgetary pressures is that colleges will look to make reductions in their cost base. And as we know, the staffing costs are the most significant element of that. And what the implications of that are is that colleges will be forced into making decisions about what they deliver, how much they deliver, how they deliver it, and the quality, ultimately, mm-hmm. of the learning. And so there are real difficult choices for colleges in all of that. We haven't done a detailed analysis of what the implications of that must be, but the implications must be that one or more or all of those elements would need to change if the 21% reduction came to pass.
Okay, thank you for that. David?
Yes, this is a huge issue for the college sector, and when we're talking about 20% and workforce reductions, what we're talking about is people's jobs. And Edinburgh College took strike action to protect jobs last year. City of Glasgow College has taken strike action to protect jobs. We've got jobs being threatened in a number of other colleges. And ultimately, you cannot deliver the same amount of high quality education and training with fewer staff, and the staff that you are losing are the experienced ones, the ones who are being encouraged to take voluntary severance, the ones that have skills and the experience of working with students, with local businesses, with local employers and so forth. And it leaves the college education in a dire place. And I think there's only one answer that the EIS can think about. We're fighting for further education to continue in the way it is, and to maintain its ambition, its scope, and its impact on people's positive impact on people's lives. But others need to also prioritise it, and it's simply not being prioritised, and it has not been prioritised by the Scottish Government for a number of years. So otherwise, as has been alluded to earlier, you're going to lose the number of courses you offer, you're going to lose the quality of the courses, you're going to lose the number of courses that are available, the access points, and you're going to lose elements of life chances being improved by colleges.
We do understand all of that, David, I think, but what I'm also wanting to allude to is the fact that there's 70% of the college's expenditure is made up from staff, and so the people are the most valuable resource. And I think it's that mismatch. The colleges are going to have to make some really challenging decisions. They don't have the money coming to them, so they have to look at all the resources, and unfortunately the situation is that staff may have to That's the decisions that are being taken by the college sectors. Do you not feel that the unions are a little bit out of touch in terms of managing the pressures and understanding the pressures that are on the leaders within our college sector across the country as to some of the challenging decisions that they have to take? As hard as it is, they have to, within the financial environment that they work in, with the lack of flexibility that they have, that these are decisions that they have to take.
Well, trade unions do not support redundancies or people or workers losing their jobs. And I think that we believe that the redundancies are not the sole responsibility of the college principals, but they're the responsibility of the Scottish Government that has placed a funding regime over many years that has led to where we're at. I mean, you know, the background papers to this committee show that the cuts that have been made in the past have already pared the sector down to the bone. The only place left where cuts or efficiencies may be applied is in staffing numbers. Now, we, the staff of the sector, will fight for the sector. And I think to sort of expect us to say, well, yes, the funding is difficult, but funding is being prioritised elsewhere, and therefore it's quite right for lecturers to lose their posts in the reality of the situation, is something that we're not going to accept. And we will be fighting for posts. And, there are many colleges now who are at the edge of tipping points of going into further disputes around redundancies. And I think, even the Scottish Funding Council in one of its reports recognised that the FE sector staff do fight for their sector. And I think that's something that should be very proud of. It's fair work. You respect your workers and you expect your workers to deliver the best for their employer and to be engaged in what they do.
Okay. Pam, you've got a supplementary before I might come back in.
Pam Duncan Clancy. Thank you, convener. I support what you're saying about the workforce and the protection of jobs. One of the things you said a moment ago was around targeting voluntary redundancies.
It's not on.
We've had a small technical issue.
Not on yet. No. Bill, yours is on.
The mic?
No, it's on now,
oh,
Pam.
We're back.
Yeah, you're on now.
Thank you. Forgive me. So what I was going to ask was, you mentioned about targeted and voluntary redundancies. Are you noticing a pattern in where what staff are being targeted for voluntary redundancies, which actually seems to be quite a contradictory statement, if I'm honest, but I'm hearing about it. I have heard about it in various colleges, including in Glasgow.
I think that colleges have been placed in a situation where their funding agency and the government for which they are responsible to expect them to make staffing cuts. Also, they know that compulsory redundancies, are the government's last choice, if you like. So therefore, they are trying to get to a position where they get rid of the staff that they need to get rid of in a way that they aren't made redundant. And one of the euphemisms for that is called a targeted voluntary severance. And that is ongoing in a number of places.
Are you noticing a pattern in what's being targeted?
Well, colleges sit down and they work out which courses they wish to pull. And then they have conversations with people who deliver those courses, and then they see whether they can displace some people from one course to another, and onto other work, and that's the type of conversations that happens in colleges up and down the country, and that's a sort of culture in which college lecturers are currently working within.
Can I come to Michelle Thompson, then we'll come to Ross.
Good morning. Sorry, I kind of jumped about a bit. I wanted to come to yourself first, David, and just flesh this out a bit. You said earlier that colleges shouldn't consider economic impact, but then you qualified that, and do come back to me if I've misunderstood anything, that as a strategy shouldn't be the primary consideration. So given that kind of qualification, could you highlight where you think that there should be consideration of the economic benefit from colleges?
I'm sorry that I haven't been clearer earlier. I think what I've been trying to say is that colleges should be a balance, and the work that they do should be focused on the needs of the individuals, the students, and also the needs of local employers. And both of those, investment in both the individuals and in getting skills for the workforce, the local workforce, both of them have an economic impact. And I think that colleges, the third panel member that unfortunately couldn't be with us today, Mary Spoge, her work really set out that economic impact. We're in favour of colleges continuing that work, and please don't misunderstand me in any way, other than to say that we do not believe that the prime function, the focus of colleges should be supporting business. It's simply a role, not the role. And going forward, many colleges build up very close relationships with employers in the locality, and build up sandwich courses and liaison and upskilling of the workforce as well. And we would be very keen for that to grow in the future.
Okay, that's helpful. So just to play it back so that I'm clear, and I will bring yourself in, Mark, in a minute. I think we're using the two different terms. One, you're pointing out a straight alignment potentially with local businesses where course provision is predicated on what they may assess as their needs at that point in time, whereas the point I'm making, and I'm keen to, I just wanted to get that clarification, the wider understanding about economic benefit that being fleet of foot in course provision can bring. For example, around net zero, some of the skills we might need where businesses haven't yet necessarily understood what they need, particularly if they're SMEs, but we may know at an academic level. So I think, are you making that distinction that you understand the economic benefit?
I think the colleges bring huge economic benefits, and you know, one of the University of Strathclyde's report on that sets that out very clearly. In many ways, training people brings an economic benefit. Training people to give skills for local gaps in the employment market brings economic benefits. We want colleges to be fleet of foot in the way that you describe. But that is simply a role they play.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and Mark, I don't know if you have anything to add to this, because I've got a wee supplementary as well.
I will, just briefly. It's the question here about whether we're being clear that we understand that colleges themselves do not have complete freedom to determine what it is that they deliver. And I think it was this committee itself in its consideration of matters last year that said that if the funding arrangements stay as they are, then the Scottish Government and the Funding Council need to provide colleges with a clear steer on what they should be prioritising. So there's an element of this that comes back to what the government asks of colleges, and I think that is something to do with clarity of purpose and subsequently, when funding gets tight, what are the priorities that need to be addressed? And then whatever's left, I think, is where the college can exercise that freedom of choice.
And within that framing then, what consideration for social considerations in terms of course provision? What's your thoughts, David, about how we can prioritise that?
Sorry, I don't understand the question.
So I'm trying to understand what social considerations colleges should make, contribution to society, and I think you've kind of highlighted that earlier in your remarks, when they're considering course provision.
I think if a student wants to do hairdressing, then the college should provide that course. If a student wants to become a nuclear scientist and wants to start their journey with a science or physics N5 qualification or up to be hires, then it should provide that course. I mean, it's about providing a broad education and training for a range of interests and aspirations that, that students and local communities have, and not simply fitting it to what the local employers say they want.
Mm-hmm. Mark, any final comments?
Nothing from me.
Thank you.
Ross, can we, Ross Greer, can we bring yourself in now? So we're going to go back a wee bit, I think. And
yeah, thanks. If it's okay, just to follow up very briefly on what David said there about the courses college provide, is it realistic to expect every college to be able to offer every course, though?
Yes.
And I mean, you talked about in Glasgow, though, it's not, it wouldn't be advisable for us to move to a model of having a single college for Glasgow. If we're talking about multiple colleges, like what we've got in Glasgow at the moment, there's three colleges in Glasgow. Should all three colleges provide every course, or can we recognise that actually maybe centres of specialism in an area where you have multiple colleges that a young person or any student could realistically commute to, that it'd be more effective for some colleges to be able to develop a depth of expertise in certain areas?
The problem with having areas and centres of excellence is that many students will find it difficult to travel to them. So when there were three colleges in Edinburgh, there were some places that you had some courses that were being delivered in three separate locations. Now you've got one college, it's some courses are delivered in one location. And it means that some people will find it very difficult to travel in that one location, even in one city. You know, travelling from the east of Edinburgh to the west of Edinburgh on public transport, if you're a part-time person with caring responsibilities, is going to be a significant problem. And colleges aren't like universities. You don't, you know, there are exceptions, obviously, but in general, colleges serve their local communities. So if you want a universal type of college provision, then you should have the colleges need to be able to provide that universal service, each one of them, because colleges do not... So coming to Glasgow, Glasgow is a big city. There are parts of Glasgow in the right transit line you can get from one part to another very quickly, but there are other parts that are not. And yes, you know, the City of Glasgow's got a specialism in nautical affairs. Clearly not every college is going to have that. But I think we want to keep the general principle that all colleges provide a broad base of course provision in order to allow the maximum number of people to attend them. And I don't want to create special cases for Glasgow to apply then for the rest of the country.
Thanks. I'd love to get into that in more depth, but there's actually one other area that I was supposed to be asking about. So just very briefly on Fair Work. My understanding is, and this goes back to what Mark said a moment ago of what the Scottish Government expects of colleges. One of the things the Scottish Government expects of colleges is a commitment to Fair Work principles. My understanding is colleges include some reference to that in their outcome agreements with the SFC, but what is then totally unclear is whether there is any real enforcement around that. Are either of you aware of how colleges are being evaluated by the SFC in relation to their commitment to Fair Work, and if action is ever taken against a college for failing to meet those commitments?
I'll start that one. In the last few days, I've written to the Funding Council to ask that. It's my understanding that no college is considered a Fair Work employer by the staff that work within them. And that whilst there is ongoing discussions at the NGANC around Fair Work status and all that type of thing, the reality is that the staff that work within colleges do not believe that they are being treated fairly or that they are Fair Work employers.
Mark?
It's been several years since I looked at outcome agreements, but the bit I could maybe talk about is that where the SFC considers that colleges haven't met the requirements of the outcome agreement, then they have the opportunity to take action, usually in the form of either withholding or recovering funding. I'm not sure how far that works on individual aspects of the outcome agreements. As I say, it's been some years since I looked at them.
Thanks very much.
Okay, thank you. Can we come now to some questions from Ruth McGuire, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Thanks for your answers so far. This committee has been interested in the financial flexibilities for colleges. Just acknowledging that we are all operating in really challenging times. Obviously, we want colleges to be as free to manage their resources in a way that works for them. Would either of you have opinions on what further flexibilities the Scottish Government and SFC could explore with the college sector?
I don't at the moment. Again, it's something we'll probably pick up due as part of the forthcoming work that we're talking about publishing in September. I know that the Funding Council has obviously looked at a range of actions in relation to the funding model. I think there are mixed opinions in the sector about the extent to which those flexibilities will address some of the underlying challenges. Nonetheless, it's an indication that there is an intent and a desire to introduce a degree of flexibility for colleges, which may help at least some of them to deal with in-year challenges. Whether it's enough, as I've said before, whether some of these changes are enough to address the financial sustainability question is another matter.
Okay, I appreciate that. David, would you have a view on that?
Yeah, I mean, we would support colleges having greater greater financial flexibilities. It would help in long-term planning. The obvious one is being able to carry reserves over from one year to another, and I think the Scottish Funding Council is looking at that. The only caveat I would say to that particular provision, which we would in principle welcome, is that currently colleges are finding it difficult to balance the books, and it's only really in a time of plenty that allows you to make those savings that you can pass on to the next year. And so I don't think that is a short-term solution.
Okay, thank you. Obviously, the ONS classification is limiting in some ways. Would you have any views on measures that could be explored to enable colleges to raise revenue, for example?
I mean, it's not something that we have specific policy on, but we've got no problems in colleges having multiple revenue streams.
Yeah, I mean, I think the challenge for colleges in a difficult economic climate it is difficult to exploit those funding streams, and we're still in the process of obviously the pandemic recovery, so that has a longer term impact too. So maybe in the fullness of time there will be greater opportunities, but I think at the moment it's very difficult.
Okay. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Thank you very much. That actually brings the first evidence session we've got this morning to a close, and I'd like to thank our witnesses for your time this morning. We're now going to have a suspension until 10:30 to allow for a change of witnesses, and I now suspend the meeting. Okay, thank you. Sorry, wait till what? Great stuff. Welcome back, and we're now going to hear evidence from our second panel on university funding. And can I welcome Dr. Gavan Conlon, partner from London Economics. Hello. Ellie Gormersall, President, National Union of Students Scotland. Morning. And Mary Senior, Scotland official from the UCU Scotland. Good morning, everyone. And I want to thank you all for your written submissions. And we're going to move straight to members' questions. And this panel, we're going to kick off with questions from Ross Greer, please.
Thanks, convener, and good morning, everybody. The Scottish Government has been recommended across a whole range of reports over recent years to set out a clear vision for the university sector. Last year, we saw the publication of the vision for the tertiary sector overall. Do you now think that the Scottish Government has made clear what its vision for the sector is and provided the kind of strategic direction that a lot of universities have been asking for?
Big one to start. Off? Who wants to go first? Mary?
Yes, convener. Thanks, Ross Greer, for your question. I guess a lot of time was spent on the purpose and principles document, and indeed UCU and some of our members were consulted and involved in that process, and it certainly does reflect some of the issues that we raise, particularly around workload, in terms of the importance of education for personal development. Education is clearly an important economic driver, but it does so much more. So I think that document certainly does set that out. I think there's a concern that the funding doesn't really match what we want to deliver, and I think that's why we're here today. And you know, from UCU's perspective, we've got real concerns on the year-on-year real terms cuts to, particularly to teaching education, to funding the, you know, the teaching that happens in universities, and it's getting to an unsustainable position. And I think it's been brought into sharp focus this year because the model in Scotland depends so much on cross-subsidy from international students and the fees that they pay, and the fact that we've got some challenges now in terms of attracting international students to universities in the UK and in Scotland. And yeah, it's incredibly challenging, and you know, we're seeing job cuts, we're seeing voluntary severance schemes, so that's putting in jeopardy that we believe, you know, all of the excellent stuff that the universities do in terms of research, widening access, knowledge exchange. So yeah, so I think that's quite a long answer to your question. You know, it was an important exercise that happened, but if the money doesn't match what we need to deliver, there's a real problem, and there's a real problem right now.
Thanks. Keen to follow that up, but if others want to come in the initial question first. Then.
I mean, I can only really echo sort of what Mary has already said, but I think the point around sustainability is really, really key here. I think that it's very well and good having purposes and principles and a clear vision, but if that vision isn't followed up by action, then it kind of leaves lots of questions open. I think that particularly the sustainability of the funding in the longer term, and when we talk about the sustainability of the funding, I deliberately don't use the word funding model there, because I think there's lots of questions around the funding model that I'm sure we'll come on to later on in the session. But fundamentally, when you look at the amount of money, for instance, to fund each student under the free tuition scheme, since that scheme first started, that money initially covered the cost of teaching each student. That has gone down, and for the first few years that remained the case, and since then that's gone down, and we've now seen this situation where fee-paying students are having to quite significantly cross-subsidise the cost of education. And so I think that, yeah, in the longer term, I think we have to, right now the current funding situation, if it continues to go on, and particularly with a lot of the uncertainty around particularly international students at the moment, then I think we're going to have a very, very tricky time on our hands.
Thanks. Dr. Conlon, do you want to add anything at this point?
I mean, very briefly, I mean, the vision set out in the document was the political vision. So I don't have really anything to say about that. But one thing I would say is that visions are generally optimistic or positive. I think there needs to be very serious concern and attention paid to the negatives and what is the vision or what is the response of the Scottish Government if a university shuts down? Because I think there is a very, very significant risk of that.
On that point, picking up from what you've all said around fiscal sustainability and Mary's point of what we've effectively seen is real terms cuts year on year, how would you suggest that the tension there is resolved? Because the Scottish Government's overall budget has not gone up in real terms. That's out with the Scottish Government's control. Both UCU and NUS have urged the government to make better use of devolved taxation powers, which is a legitimate enough position, one my party would agree with. But even with that, you wouldn't have been able to keep up with real terms inflation in recent years. So what does sustainable funding for the sector look like in a situation where the current devolution settlement means that matching real terms inflation, and inflation obviously being out with the control of the Scottish Government, but matching real terms inflation is not realistic for the overall Scottish Government budget? Are you saying that within the budget overall, a higher proportion should be allocated to HE? And if so, where would you suggest that comes from? Or is there something else that you mean by sustainability there, a more fundamental reform of the funding model?
Dr. Conlon?
If I can.
Yes.
Okay. So when we've modelled the fees and funding system in Scotland compared to the other countries of the UK, it's a very high level of public investment in Scotland. It's five times higher than in England per head of per capita. And most of that goes on teaching grant and tuition fee support. Universities are relatively underfunded in Scotland compared to England, Wales and Northern Ireland. They're the least well funded. Okay. At the moment, so despite the Scottish Government putting in five times the amount as in England per head of population or per capita, universities are at least well funded, which means essentially students and graduates in Scotland, Scottish domiciled students and graduates, have the best outcomes. Okay. So in England, and I'm not saying this is the correct approach, in England, an English domiciled student contributes about 16% of the cost of higher education, and the Exchequer contributes 84%. In Scotland, essentially, students are actually paid to go to university. The level of contribution amongst by the Scottish Government is more than 100%, because there are free fees, and there's maintenance, and there's loan write-offs. So the balance of contribution is wrong, because the benefits to higher education are accrued, you know, more widely. They're accrued by the individual and by the public purse. So there should be a balance of contribution, as in, for instance, Northern Ireland, where it's very even. So, honestly, if you want to fund institutions better so they can punch their weight, and they already sort of punch their weight, but if they want to have them comparable to England, essentially there has to be some form of additional cost passed on to graduates. They don't pay enough compared to elsewhere in the UK. So that might be the introduction of real interest rates, that might be reducing the repayment threshold, that might be introducing fees in some way, shape or form, or a graduate endowment, whatever you want to call it. But that would certainly save a huge amount of resource compared to the current state of play. So by introducing the English system in Scotland, that would save the Scottish Government 40% of its total cost of higher education overnight. And that cost will be passed on to graduates, wealthier graduates.
Thank you. I'm sure both unions have strong positions on the issues that have just been raised there.
Yeah, so I think, unsurprisingly, NUS is very strongly opposed to any form of sort of tuition fee, no matter what you call it, graduate endowment, etc., etc. I think there was research actually by UCU. Sorry to steal your thunder, but back in 2020, it found that two-thirds of university applicants would potentially be put off going to university if fees were introduced. Now, to come back to the question around, okay, what does sustainability actually look like? So I think, first of all, the thing that we have to do is look at what we're currently, where we are right now and what we're not currently doing. So, for example, things like progressive taxation, but also looking at the wealth that currently exists within universities themselves. And again, I'm not suggesting here that the fact that principals being on salary several times that of the First Minister, if we fix that, then we would fix all the problems of the universities. Of course we wouldn't. But I think that when you have such injustices as that, and when we've got huge amounts of money being spent within universities on, you know, new buildings, some of which are important in terms of facilities and infrastructures for students to learn in, but others which I would maybe describe more as vanity projects, I think that that becomes a challenge. We've also got, and I would echo in the previous session around colleges, we talked a little bit around sort of reserves and things like that. Reserves are important for universities to have, but we've got, I think, just two universities in Scotland which have got billions of pounds in reserves, actually more money than what the Scottish government is allowed to hold in reserves itself. So I think that there's a conversation that needs to be had about where the wealth that currently exists within the education system is going. And that's also more, that's broader than just the universities as well, because I also think that, and we just talked in that previous session around colleges, and it's important to say that at NUS we represent both college and university students, so some of our answers might sort of touch a little bit on colleges here as well, that when we look at the college system, which is different to the university system, and rightly so, but there is, I think there's a lot of pressure on a lot of students to go to university when that's not always necessarily the right path for them, and that colleges and apprenticeships and other forms of learning are actually perhaps the correct path, and that's also, that has financial implications as well. So yeah, that, those are just some of my thoughts there.
Thanks, convener. I think this is about political choices, and certainly in the University and College Union, we absolutely supported and support, continue to support the decision that I think all political parties around this table have signed up to, which is that higher education should be free to those that are able to participate in it. My understanding is all political parties believe that, and we're in the 2021 elections with that commitment in their manifesto. So UCU agrees with you and welcomes the fact that all, you know, there's consensus among political parties on that point. I think where there's a difference is we believe that that commitment that you've all made, that political choice, needs to be properly funded through the public purse, you know, and I think that's, you know, we're here today because that's what's becoming more challenging. You know, I'm not going to sit here and play one public sector worker or one public service off against another. Our submission made reference to the really good work that the STUC has done around progressive taxation and how the Scottish Parliament, Scottish Government can still use more of its tax-raising powers and revenue-raising powers. Last month, the University and College Union did a UK-wide report which also offered other solutions in terms of employer national insurance contributions or increases in corporation tax. I think the one point I did agree with Gavin around is that the outputs from universities are widely shared. You know, there clearly is an individual advantage from going to university, but, you know, our public services, our economy, businesses all benefit tremendously from the skilled graduates that come out with a range of different skills to use in society. Graduates are healthier, they participate in democracy, in society, in greater numbers. So there's a real well-being for all of us. From UCU's perspective, it feels that, you know, employers could contribute more. So, you know, if we were to go down that route, I think that's where we would want to go. But as I said at the start of my contribution, there is a political consensus. All political parties in Scotland agreed that this was a priority. So it's absolutely vital that we put that funding there to support universities to, you know, to continue to be the excellent institutions, supporting people, anchor institutions in their communities and so forth.
Dr. Connell?
I mean, it's a technical point. I mean, one thing, I mean, businesses should contribute to the cost of higher education because they receive one third of the benefits. Okay, so I think that's, you know, pretty obvious. Even after the higher salaries that they pay, businesses should contribute more. This point about university wealth, it's really sort of potentially quite misleading. So institutions, you know, more than half the higher education institutions in Scotland are in deficit. Whichever way you look at it, you can different form measures of deficit, but essentially they're running seriously on their overdraft. Probably about half of those institutions don't have any sort of reserves whatsoever to cover essentially their overdraft. So the financial sustainability, and when people talk about wealth and reserves, it's very tricky. You have to look at what those reserves actually mean. A lot of those reserves are restricted. Somebody might have donated X million pounds, and that's restricted for a specific purpose to fund a chair in philosophy or whatever it might be. It can't be used for any other purpose. In terms of capital expenditure and building new buildings, et cetera, a lot of this is done out of borrowing. So most institutions don't have £100 million in the bank just to build a multiplex or whatever it might be, or a science lab. This is essentially done out of borrowing, and the costs of borrowing are now, you know, the 10-year UK gilt is trading at 4.2%. This is not cheap anymore. So, you know, institutions generally are not sitting on a pile of cash. The other point is their assets are not necessarily current assets. The current asset is the key measure. You might have an old building, or you might have a science lab, but you can't just turn that into cash within the next 12 months. You either can't sell it, or it's unsellable for whatever reason, or it can't be repurposed. So institutions generally aren't sitting on, you know, bundles of cash. And the other thing I would sort of say is FE colleges do an awful lot of heavy lifting in the Scottish education sector and are desperately underfunded. I mean, universities are incredibly well off compared to FE colleges. And there's a lot of throughput from FE colleges, and I think something legitimately has to be considered in terms of FE colleges to bail them out.
Thanks. I'd love to get into the details of the disparity in reserves and things, but I believe other colleagues are going to come on to some of that later on.
We'll see if we've got time then. We can pick that up with again.
Thank you.
Bill Kidd now, please. Thanks.
Yes, thanks very much, convener. You've covered quite a great deal about the difficulties of where finance is coming from in terms of both universities and further education. In terms of increasing private sector involvement in the university sector, what would the key considerations of the Scottish Government, the SFC and the institutions themselves have to be in terms of where we stand just now with the financing, and if there was a greater look to where money could be sourced from the private sector as well?
You're all looking. Who wants to come in first? We'll start with yourself, Elliot.
Yeah, I'm happy to. So I think when it comes to private sector involvement, and I think that the word involvement is somewhat key here, and we have no issue with the idea of so, for example, as has been mentioned, big businesses might be one of the biggest recipients, actually one of the biggest benefactors higher education and universities, other than the students and graduates themselves, and absolutely should be contributing financially to that. Involvement, I think, is something that's beyond that, and I think it's important that our education systems remain independent in terms of the education itself. I think also free from the sort of influence as well of what courses, etc., are necessarily going to be not so much offered if there's more courses being offered as a result of, but if you've got courses that are potentially being cut. And this comes back, I think, to the same conversations that were had in the previous session around colleges. And I would echo David Belsey's comments there around the issues that can arise from private sector involvement in terms of course provision, etc. I think we have to recognise that education is a net good to society in and of itself. And I think that can absolutely continue when you've got businesses, for example, financially contributing to the cost of education. But what you don't want to get into is a situation where it's only the courses that are being funded by those private businesses, private investment, etc., that are able to be sustainable, that are able to continue, etc. I think that would be very worrying. And I think that we see, I mean, there's universities across Scotland, I believe one who's having their Senate meeting today, where there's a discussion around essentially cutting all courses that have got 15 or fewer students studying on them. And that is really worrying to me, because even if you've got a course that has a very, very small number of students on them, it can be really, really important, really critical for those students. And I think we start to see more and more of these decisions being made based on where the money can come in. At the moment, we see that based on particularly international student income. So courses which are really, really popular, particularly things like community education, which is something that across both colleges and universities, something which can be hugely important for home students, but doesn't bring in the big bucks from fee-paying students. We see these courses consistently being cut because they're not financially viable, I would argue. Profitable is the more appropriate word there. And so I think when we're talking about private sector investment, those same considerations need to come into that as well.
Okay, thank you.
Sorry, that the students that are doing those community engagement courses are only getting £1,800 from the Scottish Government versus what the fees they may get from if they were travelling from elsewhere.
So this is exactly the issue. I mean, it's not the student who receives, I mean, in terms of the institution, the amount that they're receiving. So the amount that the institution receives for that home student is significantly less.
So perhaps you're arguing for reform of fees and how universities are funded. Can I come to Mary Senior now, please?
Yeah, no, thanks, Convener. I guess an interesting question, and I think Ellie touched a bit on it, that, you know, businesses usually do their business to make profit, and there's maybe that sort of tension in terms of what we're looking to deliver in an education system. I think I'd also flag up concerns around academic freedom. You know, clearly it's important that universities have that freedom, academics, students have the freedom to, you know, pursue a range of sort of disciplines, research projects and so forth without external interference in that way. So I guess there's a, you know, there's a question on how that would work. Albeit, I mean clearly I know that there's lots of examples of charities, businesses working successfully with universities, but, you know, that academic freedom issue is key. You know, where we have seen the private sector in universities, it's mainly been in sort of contracting, you know, cleaning, catering, that sort of thing. And again, trade unions have a concern about a two-tier workforce. You know, are the people that are delivering the, you know, the canteens, the cafes and so forth, if it's outsourced, you know, are they on the living wage? You know, do they have decent terms and conditions? So, you know, I think that's a really important issue to consider here, and you know, maybe have a look at the report that UCU did, because, you know, if you're talking about greater employer involvement in or business involvement in higher education, I think that's why we were proposing a sort of levy on employers, because then the funding council, or, you know, the arm's length body, has oversight on how that is spent to the best of, you know, in the best interests of higher education in Scotland, not, you know, the whim of a business person.
And Bernard Gavin.
So, when you were asking about alternative streams of funding, and I mean, that was essentially the nature of the question, wasn't it? So, I mean, if we assume for a second that, like, you know, teaching grant is fixed, research funding is centrally determined, the number of international students is, let's assume, that it's sort of fixed or stable, let's say. The only other source of funding is from businesses. Okay, so it can either be indirect, i.e. through some sort of contribution, employer levy of some nature, or it's direct with institutions. So this moves on to things like commercialization and activities. So institutions, because of the lack of opportunities elsewhere, because essentially, attracting international students has been sort of done. Okay, there's not much left to do there. But there are commercialization activities. So there is information on this. So lots of institutions, they do, you know, lease out their or provide facilities, hire, et cetera, et cetera. Let, you know, hire out computing power, laboratories, et cetera, et cetera. So this is extremely useful. They do generate some income. Certainly it's the case that institutions don't maximise that. Estates, university estates are very big, very high tech, and they probably don't exploit that to the extent that they could. Okay. Certainly the case that small businesses would very happy to pay for the use of laboratory space, for instance, where they don't have to incur the fixed cost. It's very beneficial. But this comes from the businesses. Businesses are trying to, you know, acquire these services from universities. The other thing is that universities essentially undertake an awful lot of spin-out and start-up activities among students and staff. That needs to be encouraged, very, very strongly encouraged. And whatever can be put in place to make that easier for university research to no longer be just university research and that the, you know, remain in academic journals, but get out into businesses, whatever can be done to achieve that will be very beneficial for institutions, whether it be some form of, you know, funding or, you know, loans or business development loans or R&D loans or whatever it might be, anything that can be given to universities to help them promote their commercialization activities in partnership with businesses would reduce the burden elsewhere in the public sector.
Can I just ask, if you don't mind, can I just ask then on the back of what you're saying there, Gavin, how would universities themselves be becoming part of the private sector, if you know what I mean, by doing that? No?
No, I mean, essentially, the way the commercialisation activities normally work is that there's some spin-out which is based on some university research. It might be cancer research or whatever it might be. And a new company is set up where the IP is the university research, and the university would own a share alongside some commercial partners. So they would own 20 or 30%, and if that company is ever floated and goes public on a stock exchange, then they would reap the benefits of that 20% equity or 30% equity share. But this is very significant, and if you look at the universities that are the best at this, I mean, some of them are people like University of Edinburgh, Cambridge, Oxford, Imperial, where they have very, very strong research, which is then commercialised. But that certainly bolsters their financial position.
Okay. Can I just ask on the back of that then, and maybe Ellie and Mary have something to say about it as well, how does that affect the student experience, if you know what I mean? Because the research facilities and so on were initially set up in order to provide the learning facility for the people who were attending university as students. Would they still be benefiting from that if this was developed more greatly, if you know what I mean?
I don't have an awful lot of sight over this particular topic, to be perfectly honest, although I am aware that there's a number of situations, particularly where you've got postgraduate and PhD students in particular, who are really at the heart of a lot of these sort of spin-out organisations. As I say, I don't have an awful lot of sight over it, but I'm aware that students are often quite heavily involved, even in these spin-out companies. And, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Do you know, I think I'm just a bit concerned at the sort of suggestion that might be being made that spin-offs or expanding that sort of activity, which, you know, clearly is incredibly legitimate and really important. And, you know, Gavin mentioned the University of Edinburgh and yeah, Edinburgh does really well in this area. But the idea that then cross-subsidised the core of what universities do, for me, I think is problematic. You know, we need resourcing to the teaching budget in universities, and, you know, we've been using the fees of international students to a large extent to cross-subsidise this, because the teaching grant that's provided by the Scottish Funding Council, you know, via the Scottish Government, has been diminishing. And, you know, I'm really not sure that is the answer. You know, it's going to sort of divert resources into focusing on that rather than doing what is really important, and that's delivering teaching supported by research, definitely. But I think that's my key point.
I certainly agree with that. you know, anything to do with commercialisation should be extra, shouldn't be instead of, and it shouldn't be used as a sticking plaster to address other issues. The one thing I would sort of say is, you know, the leasing of laboratory time or computer processing time, this shouldn't ever displace core activity, ever. It should be complementary. It should be taking place at times where students know, you know, don't require the laboratory, et cetera, whatever it might be. So it should be additional, it should be a complement rather than a substitute.
That's really helpful. Thank you very much.
Ruth McGuire, can I bring you in, please?
Yeah, convener. Actually, in some ways, Dr. Collins' responses have actually drawn out what I was going to ask about in terms of opportunities and positive things that can come from involvement. I appreciate the caution or worry expressed as well, but I think in terms of the entrepreneurial work that can go on, there's opportunity for students and for our country as well in that.
Okay, thank you. Can we, just looking around the room, Pam Duncan-Glancy now, please. Thanks.
Thank you, convener. Good morning. Thank you for the evidence you've submitted and also for answering the questions so far. My questions are going to take us a bit of a different direction, so it's difficult to extrapolate this from the funding model, but for a minute it's just to get an understanding of what is the impact of the current model and budget on institutions, students and staff? Anyone can start.
Oh, Mary or Ellie? Sorry.
I don't mind. Thank you to Pam Duncan-Glancy for that question. The impact on staff is incredibly challenging. In our submission, we outline the fact that a good number of universities, that there have been voluntary severance schemes, threatened redundancies, redundancies happening right now because, universities are struggling. They're looking to reduce staff, and that's going to have a really detrimental impact upon the student experience. It's also going to mean that workloads for academics, professional support staff, workloads that were already incredibly high are going to be even higher and become unsafe. One of the things that we've also seen in the sector over the last sort of decade or so is this real proliferation of insecurity, job insecurity, so high numbers of fixed-term, hourly paid, you know, these sorts of casual employment contracts, which make it really difficult for people to make ends meet, to know, you know, to pay their rent, to you know, be able to get accommodation. So that job insecurity, which, you know, on top of the voluntary severance schemes, it has been really acute in universities. For example, you know, Robert Gordon University is facing really severe cuts right now. You know, look at, you know, hundreds of staff potentially are going to be leaving that university, which, you know, is really awful. But other institutions, you know, we've got a voluntary severance scheme that's been running at the University of Aberdeen. We've seen real pressures there. But across the sector, it's been really awful. In terms of pay levels for staff, you know, pay has lost value. You know, sat here in 2021 and said pay had lost value by 20% at that point. You know, it's even more stark right now that the, you know, pay just hasn't kept pace with inflation or other sectors. You know, we want to encourage people to be coming into universities, you know, because what they do is so important. Also want to talk a bit about pensions, because I think one of the concerns that we have is relates to the Scottish Teachers' Pension Scheme, and that's the scheme that operates in the newer, the post-92 universities, so like Robert Gordon, Glasgow, Caledonian, Abertay, Napier. So lecturing staff in those universities have to be in the Scottish Teachers' Pension Scheme by law. So, you know, they can't opt out or do anything different. This is a scheme that it's a public scheme, so the Treasury is the ultimate arbiter
of this scheme, and in the most recent valuation, which took effect from the 1st of April, just there, 2024, that the employer contributions in that scheme increased by 3% for the Scottish Teachers' Pension Scheme. So, those universities, the post-92s, are having to find an additional 3% in terms of the staffing cost. Complicated. This is also true for colleges and schools, and it's true for the teachers' pension scheme, which is the equivalent scheme in England. And the reason this increase happened is because of Treasury rules. They could have done something different, but you know this is what's happened. And the money is basically going. You know, that additional 3% that universities, colleges, schools in Scotland will be paying just goes to the Treasury. Now, in England, the UK government has committed and is funding the additional contributions for schools and colleges. So there are Barnett consequentials for the Scottish government for schools and colleges. And the same thing happened in 2019, and ourselves and University of Scotland had asked the Scottish government if it could fund that increase in costs, and it did do, so that was great. We asked again in October last year if it could do the same thing this year, and we didn't get responses, and we kept asking, we kept seeing what was happening, but the only thing we got that when the budget allocations came out from the Scottish Funding Council, they've not funded the increase, and they've actually taken away the additional funding they gave to post-92s in 2019, which, you know, I think helps to explain why post-92 universities are in such a challenging situation right now. There was an added complication to this issue because the teachers' pension scheme increases in England were 5%. So I was asking the Scottish Government, if it's 3% in England and 5%... Sorry, if it's 3% in Scotland and 5% in England, and you're getting the Barnett consequentials for schools and colleges, so aren't you getting a bit more that you could use to support the post-92s? But I've never had an answer to that question. And actually, part of me putting it on the table for you today is that, you know, I really want to know what happened there, because I would have thought that my understanding of how the funding process works between Westminster and the Scottish Parliament is, you know, you should have got, if they were getting 5% more for colleges and schools in England, you should have got that, and so there would have been a surplus because it was only 3% for the uplift. I know that's, you know, an important point, but it has put so much pressure on the post-92s and staff. So sorry, that was a long answer.
No, it's really helpful. And before I come to Ellie and Gavin, if it's possible, on the post-92s, and the issue you've just highlighted is something the committee can consider, potentially we could, finding out from the government the position on that. But on the post-92s, those universities are particularly well known for their widening access work that they do. And in your submission, you've said that some of the concerns around the budget could put widening access at risk. The government have said it won't, but their own equality impact assessment said it could. So there's quite a bit of confusion. What's your position on this?
Yeah, we're deeply concerned because, you know, these are the institutions where we're seeing voluntary severance schemes running, where staff headcount is reducing. We also know that what makes a difference in terms of a student from a widening access background getting to university, actually getting there in the first place, mm-hmm. staying there, progressing and getting out at the other end, is one-to-one contact. You know, it's been able to get extra time with your tutor. It's been able to, you know, put your questions to individuals. It's about having that additional student support to stay there, to be able to progress and succeed. So it's a real worry that headcount is reducing and we're seeing staff going, because, you know, I do think it's going to have an impact upon the student experience, and, you know, we're going to see higher student staff
ratios, which again, you know, increases already unsafe workloads for staff, but it is going to mean less contact that students can have on a one-to-one basis or, you know, small group basis with lecturers, with other professionals in the university.
Thank you.
So perhaps rather than repeating some of the issues, if you can focus in on some other issues, that would be helpful.
For sure, and I do absolutely echo everything that Mary said, particularly some of the points around staff, for example. I think it's important to remember in the context of when we're talking about staff working conditions diminishing, that's also a diminishment of student learning conditions as well. And in the context of widening access, I think sometimes we get into a bit of a trap of talking about widening access rather than talking about retention and actually once you've got someone into university, how you keep them there. So there's a couple of different aspects that I want to address in answering this question. I think first of all, in terms of the impact on the ground to students, and I think that a lot of Mary's already touched on a lot of the points around one-to-one contact. It was something I want to point out in particular, things like student mental health support, for example, and the funding that actually initially in the past 5 years the Scottish Government has directly funded the provision of student mental health counsellors within every university and college in Scotland. That funding came to an end at the end of the last academic year. And as the Scottish Government has been working on its student mental health action plan, they put in place a £3.21 million transition fund from that initial funding for councillors to the action plan. But they did that transition fund almost a year before revealing what the action plan was. So we had a transition fund, but we didn't really know what we were transitioning to within the universities. And what that means for student mental health provision is potentially counsellors on campuses disappearing, really vital support that students need, particularly in the context of encourage everyone to have a look at the Thriving Learners report that was done by University of Scotland and the Mental Health Foundation. It has some horrifying statistics around student mental health there. And I'm pointing this particular aspect around mental health out in particular because I think that's just one example of where we've seen cuts, and the very real impact that has on students. The next thing that I want to look at in terms of the sort of, I suppose, the funding model, which I touched on beforehand, is around that disparity between how much, in terms of how the money that the institutions get for funding home students and how that's been cut year after year as well. And actually, I think that funding model is potentially sustainable if the Scottish Government funded it properly. Like, the model isn't the issue here. It's the fact that initially the government was funding that at the full amount that was required, and that has then been cut gradually year after year. I think, according to University of Scotland, since 2014 to 15 academic year, the funding per student has fallen by 39%. So that's a really significant drop. And what that means is that when decisions are being made around courses to be cut, so I talked in a previous answer around things like community education, we've also seen it around things like modern languages as well, the decisions are being made on the basis of courses that are profitable to fee-paying students rather than what's actually needed by students across the piece. And that isn't to say that those courses that are really important for fee-paying students aren't also important. They really very much are, and international students are a huge, important part of our student community, and the decision should bear their needs in mind as well. But when we've got courses that are being cut because they're not financially viable, when actually what really that means is that they're not getting fee-paying students. I think it's right and absolutely okay that some courses cross-subsidise others in the current model that we've got. Ideally, I would like a system where no student, whether international or not, is paying tuition fees. In the current model that we've got, where some courses are receiving more funding than others, I think it's okay that those courses then cross-subsidise courses like modern languages, like community education, for example. I think there's quite a lot there, so I'll probably leave it at that for now, but I'm sure some more of these points will come up later on.
Thank you. No, I appreciate that. Do I have time to press further?
Bring Ben McPherson in on that theme for a supplementary.
Of course.
Brief one.
Just on that, and I've asked the government this as well, do we need to think more about having courses that are joint courses, where you have part of the course is a subject that is demanded in the market and has employability application perhaps more than others, and then other courses that are the arts, community education, you know, these things that are really important as well, in order to preserve the knowledge and make sure that there's a wide array of learning subjects that people can engage with. Do we need to think more about bringing different areas together, joint honours? I mean, I know there's a lot of joint honours already, but do we need to consider that more? Sorry if that's too much.
Right.
You can write us
it's
if,
okay.
if it's too much to answer just now.
I don't know if you can briefly respond, cause, and then maybe look to bring in Dr. Conlon as well.
Yeah, I think it's for institutions to determine their offer. I think... We don't want like excessive political interference in universities. I think it's the first question was about the purpose and principles, and I think that was helpful in terms of strategic direction. I think there's a sort of danger in sort of dictating to students and universities what they deliver and what they
that's
what
not
they
what I was,
sorry
with respect that's okay. not what I'm saying, and I say this as a philosophy graduate, and and people say well, what are you going to do with a philosophy degree? Well, actually, it teaches you to think, and it's the knowledge that's amassed over hundreds of years. We don't want to lose the ability to learn these subjects in a practical and also more competitive environment. That's why I'm considering, do we need to have more collaboration between...
I think you've just very, very well highlighted, actually, the value of single honours degrees like philosophy, for example.
Well, it was a joint honours, actually.
And I say this as someone who... I did my A-levels down south, and I did physics and theatre studies as two of my A-levels. And I think that it's important that there's flexibility, and actually, it's one of the benefits, actually, I think, of the Scottish higher education system, is that there is actually more flexibility, I think, than down south, for example, for students to dip their hands in a few different aspects. But the key thing is choice. And I think what's really important is we don't end up in a situation where really important, really valuable, and when we're talking about things like community education, when we're talking about things like the arts, languages, etc., these are really important in their own right. And you might have students who want to go and study just that language as a single honours, and they should be able to do so without having to be forced into a box of something that we're saying is more employable, etc. And actually, I think these degrees are really important over a broad range of sectors in their own right. So I would push back a little bit on that.
Contribute to any of this discussion?
Yeah. So in terms of the implications of the current funding system, so the implications are there's a very high level of public investment per capita. The level of public investment is 50% higher than Northern Ireland, it's 250% higher than Wales, and 500% higher than in England. Okay. Full-time maintenance is moderate, it's now good. It's moved from being moderate to good. Part-time maintenance is poor. There's no part-time maintenance, essentially. That's an anomaly of the system. There is something wrong there that there is no part-time maintenance. Further education colleges are underfunded, full stop. Higher education institutions are underfunded. They're 27%, they have 27% lower funding than in England, for instance. They are less well-funded than in Wales and Northern Ireland as well per capita. Okay. You can take a view on any of that. The real problem we get into now is that there are essentially implicit student number controls, or explicit, on domestic students, which limits opportunity. And in terms of the student loan repayment system, it is extremely regressive. So graduates in public sector professions pay more in net present value terms, they pay more than lawyers and bankers. So graduates who earn less over their lifetimes pay more than graduates who earn a lot more. Okay, there's something very wrong there. There's massive deadweight loss in the system. So there's a free fee system, essentially, in operation, where
many of those individuals in receipt of the free fees would have gone to university anyway. So there is essentially middle class and wealthier households. So there's a really poor targeting of resources. And essentially the public purse is subsidising very well paid or better paid, predominantly male graduates, okay, to the detriment of female graduates, less well paid female graduates. There is the opportunity there with some restructuring of the system to put a whole lot more resource into student support, both in terms of maintenance and loans, to extend eligibility for part-time maintenance support, and there's resource there. But essentially, the poor targeting of the funding system is the most detrimental implication. And that's all arises out of the free fee system.
Okay. Right. My next question is around the current funding model, so I'll probably start off with yourself then, Dr. Conlon. I mean, how sustainable is the current funding model that we've got? And we hear from other members who will about restricted resources coming in. And so how sustainable is the current funding model that we have?
I mean, it's a political issue. I mean, it's as sustainable as you want it to be. I mean, in the sense that if you're happy with the status quo, if you think that the huge level of public investment that currently exists is adequate to meet the vision of the country, that's fine. But the issue is that there are unintended consequences in terms of distributional effects, in terms of who repays their student loans. There are very significant effects in terms of higher education institutions, and both directly and in terms of essentially now many institutions having to make redundancies. And we see it in Scotland. We see those 50 institutions in England who have essentially redundancy programs in operation. We also see it in terms of the nature of the student experience that students can expect, because universities, because they see a very significant real cut in their income, are forced to reduce the level and volume of services and the quality of the service they provide. So it, you know, yes, it's sustainable, but technically, but there's going to come a point also that, you know, at the moment there's salami slicing, all the services, everything that's been provided is getting, you know, cut. And then we're going to move into where departments of philosophy and modern foreign languages get cut. And then that's going to keep happening. And ultimately what's going to happen is an institution is going to fall over. So it's not for me to say whether that's sustainable. If you're happy to let an institution collapse, well then yes, it's sustainable, but that might not be ideal.
Okay. And Mary Senior?
Yeah, it's the decline in funding that is the problem. So, it's not about the funding model. As I said, you know, we absolutely support the right of students to access a higher education without having to be saddled with debt and fees. But to do that, we need to invest in the sector. And, you know, as I said in my previous answer, we've seen year on year real terms cut to, particularly to the teaching grant, which, you know, that isn't sustainable. And the fact that our model has been relying on international tuition fees is problematic, because as we've seen, you know, the UK government has changed visa requirements. You know, I think in Scotland we've done well. Generally, we welcome migrants and we welcome international workers to come to live and work and contribute and to study in Scotland, but it's been increasingly difficult to continue to do that with, you know, the hostile environment and the narrative and the fact that it's more challenging for international students to bring dependents and so forth has really impacted upon Scottish universities to do that. So that element, you know, the fact that we've come to rely on that has been incredibly problematic. But, you know, I do note that, you know, there has generally been a consensus in Scotland that, you know, we do want to welcome international students and staff to live, work and study here. It's just at times it's hard for that message to be heard when we've had a UK government that's putting out a totally different message.
Liam Kerr?
I'm very grateful. Just on that point, Mary Senior, your response there to the convener, your submission, your very helpful submission that you sent in, says that the Scottish Government provides over £1 billion to higher education annually, but a decade ago it was citing exactly the same figure. Now, in your submission, you suggest that the policy of free tuition needs to be properly funded. Now, obviously, this committee is looking at the budget process, so are you able to guide us on what properly funded looks like in terms of any indicative sum?
Yeah, I mean, I'm sorry, I don't think I can give you sums, but what I'm saying is when you look at inflation and the cost of living, the amount that is given via the Scottish Funding Council hasn't kept pace. It's really challenging, and you know, I know other submissions are indicating that the unit of resources has decreased by substantial amounts. So that's the difficulty. We needed the unit of resource to keep pace with inflation to ensure that the cost of teaching is fully funded.
So if I can reflect back, just to be clear. And I appreciate I'm not going to press you for a figure, but if it was £1 billion a decade ago per your submission, that figure might meaningfully be adjusted for inflation at the very least.
Absolutely.
And that might help the committee arrive at an indicative figure from the government.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Very grateful. Convener.
Briefly, yeah, is that okay?
I think it's important to say that when the funding model was first implemented, I think it was sustainable, and I think it is the fact that we've seen cuts after cut after cut that we're now seeing these challenges and this over-reliance, for example, on cross-subsidising from international students, for example. That's actually a relatively recent thing. When we first had the policy of free tuition, that wasn't so much of a reliance because the funding kept up. So I would agree with Mary there, and I think that if we hadn't have seen these cuts, and I think it's a political decision, it was a political choice not to continue funding the universities to the degree that they actually require it for the teaching grant about 10 years ago, and then the decline that we've seen since, that's what's resulting in a lot of the challenges now.
Grateful.
I'm going to keep on the sort of funding model theme and think what sort of funding models could be considered for university education in Scotland in the years ahead. I don't know who wants to. I might bring in yourself last, Dr. Conlon, if that's okay, and see what the other panel members might want to contribute first.
I mean, I think in some ways, I think actually what I just said there, I think almost answers the question. I think the current funding model was actually funded properly.
All right.
And I appreciate that money has to come from somewhere. But I think that, as I say, 10 years ago, it was working, it was sustainable. I'm not saying there weren't challenges, but it was sufficient. And I think that, and I acknowledge again the broader sort of challenge to the public finances of the country as a whole and the government as a whole. But I think that's why we need to be making full use of all of our revenue-raising powers, because we did have a sustainable funding model 10 years ago, and that's diminished since.
I know there's been a lot of talk about the international student, but we are going to come on to some of that stuff later on, just so that you are aware of that in your responses. Mary Senior.
I'm not sure what else I can add to what we've said already and what we've said in our submission. I mean, I guess in terms of like pre-budget scrutiny, I guess we came to sort of, critique the most recent Scottish budget and hope that, we can sort of learn from that and obviously to outline the challenges that and the real the damage that's been done by continually cutting the budget. So I don't think I can say any more than that, other than, and I think we reference in our submission, the University and College Union at a UK level, has obviously been thinking about funding for institutions. We don't agree with the system in England either, and we're looking at alternatives to that. So, you can see the research and the work that we've done there, which looks at an employer levy So that's, I think, just point the committee to
Thank
that.
Thank you, Mary Senior. Can I bring in Dr. Conlon?
So I would say, I mean, as an economist, I would say, first of all, in terms of the level of shortfall that needs to go into the system, so the per capita funding in England, Wales and Scotland is about 9,600 per head. Okay, it's 7,900 in Scotland per head. That's what an HEI receives. So it's about £1,500 shortfall. Okay. So suppose there was a system where there's going to be additional resources to higher education institutions. That can either come through teaching grant, that's fine, and that costs 100%. That's 100% subsidy from the public purse. So both the people who go to university and pay taxes and the people who don't go to university pay that subsidy. General taxpayer pays that. It could be some form of deferred fee, and the proportion of the loans that are written off in Scotland is about 20%. So you can sort of say, right, we're going to introduce some sort of fee or graduate endowment or long-term repayment, whatever it might be, and the public purse picks up 20% of that and graduates pick up 80% of that. Is that unreasonable? It seems, you know, personally, it seems quite reasonable given the balance of benefits between Exchequer and the individual. It does seem to me reasonable there should be a balance in terms of contribution. That's very similar to the system that would exist in Ireland, for instance, where there's a student contribution and then there's a free fee initiative. And the two work in parallel. And the student contribution is means tested. The wealthiest students basically pay a proportion of the student contribution. I would definitely introduce something like real interest rates in terms of the repayment system. Real interest rates are a good progressive measure. What they do is they hold the highest earning, predominantly male graduates, in repayment for a little bit longer. Okay, so it basically makes them contribute a little bit more. Instead of repaying in 15 years, it's 16 years, 17 years. You don't have to have crazy real interest rates. 1%, 2% is perfectly reasonable. Given the cost of borrowing, this is a reasonable thing to do. It's the most progressive part of the system. And it stops the situation we have now where graduates in public sector professions pay more than economists, bankers, and lawyers. There's something quite fundamentally wrong about that. The third thing is, if we think about the benefits of higher education, it's a cake and it's split into three parts. The public gets about a third of the size of the cake. Graduates receive about a third of the benefit. And employers receive a third of the benefit, even after they pay the higher graduate wages. So employers don't contribute for what they receive out of, you know, what is a very, very good higher education system in Scotland. So we have done the modelling for ECU in terms of what would it cost in terms of an employer contribution. In Scotland, it's a very, very low level of contribution because there's essentially sort of a free fee system. But a typical level of contribution is 1 percentage point. 1 percentage point on national insurance would essentially eliminate student fees in England. That's what we modelled. So it's quite a moderate level of contribution for employers. We've modelled other aspects, but employers should definitely contribute more because they get so much out of the system.
Okay. Ben McPherson, are you wanting in here?
Thanks. Just briefly, in those considerations, Dr. Conlon, just speaking objectively from my perspective, do we need to think more going forward about the graduates from Scotland who have a state-funded degree course in Scotland, then leaving Scotland and paying their taxes elsewhere? I mean, I'm an internationalist. I want to see people go and work abroad and maybe come back. But if they're, particularly in the professions, particularly in the medical profession, if they are then going to work in another state and being part of that workforce long term, is this something we need to think about collectively?
I think it's very challenging indeed to make any to limit the choice of be it students or graduates. I think you have to let the, you know, the economy more generally and people to follow their own preferences. I don't think there's anything you can do. I mean, you can amend student loan repayment systems that you encourage people to, if they do leave the country after graduation, that they potentially return. There are ways of doing that. New Zealand has, for instance, their student loan repayment system. If you leave the country and do your couple of years abroad, you get hammered with interest rates, properly hammered. But if you remain in New Zealand, or once you return to New Zealand, those interest rates drop to zero. So there are ways and means of encouraging people, but it should be at the margin. You should be encouraging people as opposed to mandating.
Yeah, that's what I meant.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's very difficult. I mean, you know, the other point is the point you made earlier about like joint honours subjects. I mean, you've got to be consistent, I think. You either let students choose what to study, whether it be joint honours or single honours, or if the university permits, and then, but you've got to let graduates go and get experience, potentially return, potentially not return.
To come in on Ben's. I want to bring in a question from Liam Kerr now, please.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I'll stay on this theme, if I may, Dr. Conlon. You said right at the start, and these are the words I wrote down, so they might not be a precise quote, but I think you said there was a very significant risk of a Scottish university shutting down. And later on you talked about the potential for an institution to fall over. Could you help the committee understand what leads you to say that? And is there any indication that the Scottish Government recognises that risk and indeed is responding to it?
I mean, the second part of the question I can't answer. In terms of the first part, it's absolutely clear that universities across the entire UK are struggling financially. There is public information available from, for instance, the Office for Students, which identifies the extent to which institutions are running a deficit. And these deficits that many institutions are running are not single-digit deficits, 2, 3, 4%. They are 15, 17% deficits, unsustainable deficits. There is no reason to believe that institutions in Scotland are any different. And if anything, they might be in a worse situation given the fact that the average level of funding per head is less than in England. So, yes, you know, there is a very uneven... Looking at an average in Scotland is very misleading. Some institutions are doing fine, just. Those institutions that can rely on plentiful international students, etc., etc. There are many institutions where the overwhelming majority of their student population are domestic students, where they rely extensively on domestic fees or tuition fee grants, essentially, and these institutions are certainly in trouble, precarious.
I'll follow up with a similar question. You may be unable to answer the second point again for obvious reasons, but in your submission you set out data which you've alluded to throughout the session, that the Scottish system is costing the public purse either five times or 500%, you said earlier, more than in England, yet Scottish institutions were underfunded or receiving... Yes. In your submission, 23% less income, you said earlier, 27% less income than in England. If we assume that the Scottish Government is cognizant of these figures, what steps would you expect them to be taking to address it? And are you seeing any evidence that that's been taken?
I can't answer that. I mean, I hope the Scottish Government has seen the analysis. It's... you know, it's a very consistent analysis. It's independent, but it's also very robust. So, you know, it's a political decision, but the information is there. All the information is there. And it's not just about levels. It's not about the level of funding, just it's the distributional effects. Okay? It seems to me perverse that graduates in public sector professions generally pay more than highly paid, predominantly male graduates in banking and finance and legal services. That seems to me very odd.
I have to say that is a very I find that a very interesting point that you've made several times. You mentioned in there that this was consistent in terms of the disparity in public funding against income. Just for completeness, then, is that when you say consistent, is that over a number of years?
No, the consistency is when we do a cross-country analysis and we compare the results for England, Wales, Scotland, and Northern Ireland. The results are consistent and presented consistently, and the same metrics are used, so it is possible to do an automatic read across to understand the relative performance in Scotland versus the other countries of the UK.
I understand. I'm very grateful.
Convener. Thank you. Thank you. Can I come to some questions now from Ruth Maguire, please?
Certainly, convener. Good morning, panel. Thanks for your contributions so far. I'd like to ask about student numbers, funding places, and international students. Mary Senior, if I can come to you first, what would UCU like to see the SFC consider in its review of teaching funding that's recently been announced by Scottish ministers?
Thank you for that question. You know, I feel like I'm repeating what I've already said, but you know, I clearly it's a real concern, and it's incredibly difficult for institutions to see the teaching budget, you know, diminish in real terms. So that's a real concern for us. Sorry, you asked about international students as well.
I'll come on to that. Yeah. So it was just what you'd like them to consider while reviewing that funding. I mean, you've spoken about the impact and your concerns. Is there anything more specific you would like to?
Yeah. I guess to say, you know, international students bring a great deal of value, you know, culturally, academically. That, you know, it's a good thing to have international students that want to come to study in Scotland's universities. And, you know, our domestic students and rest of UK students will really benefit from, you know, working together with international students. I think it's become increasingly problematic that there's this sort of imperative upon institutions to bring in international students and to try and get as much money out of them as they can. So, you know, that's a real concern, that they're, you know, they're only valued for the money and the fees that they pay, rather than, you know, it's good to have somebody from overseas in your tutorial or on your course or whatever. That, you know, that should, you know, that should be the reason they're here, not because of the fees they bring.
I'll pause you for a second. I know I've misread my notes a little, and I'm treading into territory that Michelle Thompson's going to want to talk to you about. So, if I can ask instead about the impact that the removal of 1,289 full-time equivalent funded places will have on the supply and demand for Scottish domiciled students. I see, Ellie, you were nodding.
Sure,
I'm
happy to come in on that. So the reduction of places this past academic year, that was something that, don't get me wrong, it's disappointing any time that we're seeing a reduction in student numbers. This didn't come as a surprise to us because those student places were particularly put in place essentially to deal with the backlog of students during the pandemic years. Mm-hmm. So during the pandemic, one of the things that we saw was, I think particularly in the 2020 to 2021 academic year, there are a lot of students who ordinarily would have gone to university who chose to defer for a year. That then meant that the following year and the year after that, because there was a bit of a knock-on effect, there was a massive surge in the number of students wanting to attend university. So there were additional places that were put in place to deal with that backlog, essentially. Those additional funded places came to an end this past academic year, and so that meant that there was a reduction in the number of places available to Scottish domicile students. As I say, never something that we would actively welcome. It's something that is always disappointing, fewer students being able to attend university.
Sorry, just to be clear, so those numbers are the same number that were increased to deal with the
That's my understanding. That's my understanding. So, as I say, it's not something that I think it's something that is a bad thing that there are fewer places available. However, it's something that didn't come as a surprise to us. I think that there are conversations when we're talking about the number of places that are being made available. I think there's a few different conversations here because I think we can acknowledge the fact that it is not ideal and it's not necessarily a good thing that there is a cap on the number of places that are available to Scottish students here. But I think we can also weigh that with the benefits of free tuition, for example. And I think that there's a cost to that. I think that in the longer term, there's questions around, for instance, if that cap can be increased so that there's more places available. But also looking at who's going to university, as I said earlier on at the very beginning, I think there's conversations to be had, for example, around, I think a lot of the narrative is around university being, and I think partly because of the sort of cultural idea of university as being the sort of, That's where you go to get a good job, when actually the reality is that college, apprenticeships, etc., are also really, really valuable routes that I don't think are necessarily...
I know that this committee would push back on that view a bit, and we certainly take a lot of evidence about the benefits of apprenticeships and the different styles and college places. I think there is progress being made on that front.
For sure, and this is what I mean, is that I think it's really important that we're talking about the value of apprentices, that we're going into schools and talking about the value of going to college and a college education, as well as a university education, and giving them equal parity. And I think that that also naturally will have an impact on student places and the cap, etc. as well.
Thank you. Could bring down. Sorry, slightly distracted there. There's a baby very unhappy outside that's in earshot. Gavin.
I was just going to say the quality of the workforce, and quality is a technical phrase. In economics, we sort of use the average level of qualification that the labour force has. The quality of the workforce is the biggest determinant of economic growth that there is. And this country really, really needs economic growth, just full stop. So we should have more graduates. Okay, full stop. Is the higher education sector the right shape in Scotland? I don't know. We need more maths graduates, we need more philosophy graduates, we need more politics graduates. It can't just be STEM, okay? I'm going to be clear about that. But we need more graduates. Scotland is a very, very high quality higher education system. When in England, you know, Tony Blair was talking about trying to achieve a 50% target, I mean, you know, that was in the rear view mirror in Scotland. That had already essentially been achieved amongst parts of the population. So it's a very well-established, high-quality sector. Those countries that have the highest levels of economic growth have, and it's not just a correlation, also have very high proportions of graduates. Okay, Singapore, South Korea, for instance. If we want more places, the challenge is going to be funding those places. And the problem that we have at the moment in Scotland is that there's a limited number of places available, I highlighted by the reduction in the funded numbers, because of the repayment system. The public purse is already contributing so much to higher education, and because so much of that contribution is deadweight loss, and it's paying for people that would already pay themselves to go to university, essentially that limits the number of places available. So we need more graduates. We need to spread the public funding around a bit better, and we need to target it a bit better. And there are ways and means of achieving that, and everybody will benefit from that if we achieve long-term sustainable economic growth.
Can I bring Liam on a question on the student numbers?
I just wondered if Mary had wanted to come in, or are you?
You're okay.
No, it's okay.
Oh. Do you want to pick that up? It's just, and then I'll come back to you.
It's just very briefly on that exact point, so perhaps Ellie Gomersall or Mary Senior may wish to answer. So there was the cut of, let's say, 1,200 places, but at the time, so let's say around about January, I recall that the expectation was that that would save, I think, about £5 million. But there was a £28.5 million shortfall to the sector being projected. So the suggestion at the time seemed to be that there could be further cuts to places coming down the track.
Do either of you recognise that as a risk, and are you concerned about that?
I think that there is some risk. I mean, I think that ultimately, as I say, when we see the cuts year after year after year as well, I think that those cuts are coming from across the piece. I think for the most part, you know, obviously with the exception of these particular places, which, as I say, were sort of a special case, the number of places available has been one of those few things that has been maintained. I think that then means that the cuts instead have been going to, for instance, the quality of the education of the students who then do get in. So I think that I do absolutely recognise that as a risk. It is something that I am somewhat concerned about, but that is part of the bigger picture of concern around not just the number of places that are available, but the diminishing quality of education for those students who then do get one of those places.
I mean, it just feels like institutions are being asked to do more with less. I think that, you know, that's my basic concern.
I'm grateful. Convener.
And can we come now to Michelle Thompson, please?
The moment you've all been waiting for. Thank you, convener. We've danced around this for a wee while, the issue of international students, the implications on fees and the fee structure, risks to universities, and so on. And I want to come to yourself first, Dr. Conlon, for your honest assessment of where we are in terms of reliance on international students, the implications of that reliance and the risks therein, should there be some kind of major international shift, and fully accepting the comments, Mary, that you've made earlier about the drop caused by the Home Secretary's recent announcement. So it's a sort of starting there, and then I've got some follow-on questions as well.
I like a nice, easy question. So I don't think anybody would doubt that the benefit of international students to the Scottish higher education sector, directly through fee income and how that subsidises research, but also domestic teaching activity, there's no issue about that. One thing that's understated is the availability and the viability of many courses that are offered to domestic students wouldn't be viable whatsoever if we didn't have international students. Okay, so we'll take it as given that it's a very strong positive to have international students in higher education in Scotland. It makes the higher education system significantly more precarious in terms of exogenous shocks. So we have something which prevents international students from travelling to the UK, and we see many institutions that will see essentially much of their income streams obliterated overnight. Okay, so it places institutions in a much riskier position. So naturally the thing would be to think, well, it's going to be those institutions that rely most heavily on international students. And that's actually not the case, because what those institutions can do is essentially replace those international students with domestic students. Might not be as good a level of funding, but it's something to fill the hole. So essentially the impact starts to ripple throughout the sector. And those institutions, even those institutions that wouldn't be notionally heavily reliant on international students, will see the indirect effect of exogenous shocks. So that is really problematic. It's also highly problematic, I think, to rely on or rely excessively on particular countries for students. So this, again, because essentially the institution doesn't have significant control, number one. Number two, it's more to do with, you know, if you think about economic, we'll forget about political variables, but if you think about economic variables, if you have a country that experiences a 30% deflation in their currency or depreciation in the currency, essentially the cost of UK fees ramps up by 30%, and those students essentially no longer come to the UK. So you really are, you know, all of a sudden higher education institutions are somewhat becoming sort of currency speculators. You know, and that's not their core operation. And we wouldn't sort of say, you know, do you want to take a punt on the Nigerian currency this year or for the next couple of years? Probably not the best idea. So it's problematic, but the response of universities in looking for to attract additional international students, it's super rational. You have a sector which is based on intellectual ability, essentially. They're playing by the rules of the game. And if other sources of funding are stagnant, they have limited alternative except to attract international students and potentially commercialization activities, but these are much longer term strategies. So,
I mean, you've led on to my next question, because I think you very clearly set out some of the risks and their significance. So therefore, to start to rebalance that without necessarily, and obviously it needs to be staged over a period of time, what can we do to address that, given the risks that you've highlighted?
I mean, the obvious thing would be to increase the level of funding associated with domestic students. Mm-hmm. Reduce the reliance on international students. Reduce the extent to which the commercial imperatives direct institutions towards, the international student market. And you can do that at the margin by funding both undergraduate and postgraduate students better.
And you've kind of alluded to that earlier, and I know we've danced around this issue. My last question, and I appreciate that both Mary and Ellie might want to come in on this as well, is our discussions today have been quite nearside in terms of what's happening in the UK and the differences within Scotland. But the issue of how you fund higher education isn't unique, and many other countries globally have wrestled with this, how you incentivise international students, how you retain domestic students, the fairness of parity, and so on. To what extent is this a discussion that's been forced over the longer term by the decisions of the UK government to introduce a fee system with a differential with the Scottish government, and we've arrived, as Ellie's pointed out, we've arrived at a certain position. If we were looking internationally, and I know we might not want to start from here, what are the other options we can do in terms of funding models? Because the United Kingdom, or rather England with its tuition fees, is much more anomalous to what other countries do, where international students can study for free. There's a multitude of countries where they can do that. And I'm interested, particularly yourself, Dr. Conlon, because of your kind of background, if we weren't starting from here, what might we be able to do? Because I'm quite concerned we're just looking at, the recent history and development. Can I ask Dr. Conlon, but I appreciate both of you. I do want to bring you in.
So there's lots of good things. I mean, I know I've been critical of the repayment system in particular, but there's lots of good things about the funding system in Scotland. And I wouldn't throw out the baby with the bathwater. I think if I was... if I was starting again, I would just say there's lots of other countries that have looked to Scotland to consider whether, it's preferable to have the Scottish system in other countries. So Republic of Ireland is one country where they've been grappling with free fees and student contributions. And, one of the things about the Irish system is they have no maintenance loans whatsoever. And they refuse to even consider maintenance loans under any circumstances, even though that denies opportunity, I would say, and imposes credit constraints on young people and families. So there's lots of good things about the Scottish system. If I was starting again, I would have some comparability or equality between part-time and full-time maintenance. I think it's an anomaly that part-time students are treated differently from full-time students. I think given the nature of qualification acquisition and learning acquisition now, part-time study is really important and it should be encouraged. In an economy that is evolving as quickly as it is, people need to take micro-credentials and top up repeatedly. And
we should be supporting, like the government should be supporting those people who are demonstrating some desire to acquire new learning and knowledge. Okay, so that's one thing. I would, as I've said before, I would absolutely change the repayment system so that I would target scarce public resources much more efficiently than is currently the case. And that could be retained within higher education. That could be further education, that could be apprenticeships, that could be childcare, that could be whatever it is within the human capital sphere. But, you know, they would be the two main things I would do.
Okay. I appreciate that this has already been quite a wide-ranging discussion, but I wanted to offer you, Mary and Ellie, the chance to come in as well. And it may well be, Ellie, you've also got some further reflections in your role in terms of the international. So perhaps, and then we'll finish with Mary.
Yeah, so on international students, I think, first of all, is as has been said multiple times throughout the session, we have a real problem at the moment with the over-reliance in terms of international student fees. And I think actually when we look at where a lot of universities are currently putting their money at the moment in terms of the money out with the teaching grant that they do have, a lot of it is going into international student recruitment and going overseas and actively trying to get as many international students to come and study here. And I think what's really important is that international students are able to come and study here in Scotland and take advantage of our education system here and, you know, and contribute to the economy in doing so, because that's what's right for them. And I really worry that at the moment we've got this system where, because of that over-reliance, universities are going out and trying to get as many international students as they can to come here. And I think a lot of international students actually are being sold a bit of a false promise, and that's in many different regards. I think, first of all, when we look at international students' experiences once they arrive here in Scotland. So some research we did at NUS Scotland just over a year ago, we found that 12% of students across Scotland have been homeless at some point during their studies, which is already an incredibly concerning statistic. But when we look specifically at international students, that almost doubles to 21%. I know international students who arrived in Scotland and spent their first weeks in this country whilst enrolling as a student at a university in Edinburgh, sleeping at the bus station just down the road from this parliament because they were unable to find somewhere affordable to live whilst here. This is the reality that a lot of international students are facing. Compounding that then with the hostile environment policies that we're currently seeing. I think, for example, the 20-hour work cap is a real problem. And actually, international students could be coming to Scotland and studying part-time, for example, and the benefits of that to both the students and to Scotland could be huge. But at the moment, we see these real, real challenges for a lot of international students. And then that's also compounded by the further uncertainty that comes about. So we've seen some very, very damaging policies from the UK government in just the past year, particularly around the increase to the skilled workers visa salary threshold, but also the rules around dependents. And I should note as well that the rules around dependents for international students disproportionately affect women students who might be more likely to need to bring dependents with them in order to be able to study here. But also, we've seen just recently the review of the graduate root visa, for instance, which is something that the UK government ultimately settled on not changing. But the uncertainty that comes about the fact that actually the rules that apply to international students could change at any time is it massively puts off international students from coming here. And the last point that I'll make around international students in this full context is that not only to international students have a huge, huge benefit for not just their own education, being able to come and study here in Scotland, whether that's then contributing to the workforce here in Scotland or actually taking the Scottish education system away with them, or the benefits that they have to home students. I know that my own education at University of the West of Scotland was massively improved by the friends that I met from all over the world as a result of that. But also, actually, international students have a huge, huge benefit to the economy overall as well. And in looking at just the graduate visa route, for example, the economic benefit to Scotland from students taking advantage of the graduate visa route. And even when we take away, for instance, the fees that they're paying to come and study here, we're talking millions of pounds here. So there's a huge net economic benefit to having international students coming to Scotland and studying. And they should be encouraged to do that because it's what's right for that individual international student to come and study here, rather than this current system where universities are spending huge amounts of money trying to recruit as many international students to fill bums on seats so that they can pay the fees and cross-subsidise domestic student fees.
Thank you. And last comment, we've got a lovely parallel between risks and opportunity here. So last comment to yourself, Mary.
Yeah, I guess I'll be very brief because I think I was going to pick up on the importance of the post-study work visa and just reflect that it was inspired by the Scottish Parliament, the Scottish Government a number of years ago, and just the importance of that in terms of pathways for international students to study and then remain and contribute to Scotland. So yeah, that's all I've got to add.
Great. Thank you, Pam Duncan-Glancy, you're looking for a very brief supplementary on this as a final thing before we finish the session.
Thank you, Convener. It was just to pick up on your point, Ellie, around the support for international students, and obviously the funding for student support has been reduced this year. Do you think that will impact on all students, but also specifically international students?
It has an impact on all students. What I would say is that one of the particular challenges facing a lot of international students is that they have no recourse to public funds whilst here, and that means that when we look at the really, really damaging and worrying state of student poverty in Scotland at the moment, so not just the 12% of students who have been homeless, but also 37% of students who have considered dropping out of their courses because of financial reasons, the number of students who have missed meals because they couldn't afford it, and a lot of domestic students are able then to take advantage of hardship funds, which I think sticking plasters over the cracks. I don't think that's the long-term solution, but are able to at least obtain that support through some of these hardship funds, which, as I say, I don't think is ideal, but that's where we are. International students often aren't able to make use of those funds. They actually were during the pandemic. So during the pandemic, the Scottish Government recognised the particular challenges that we're facing all students, and a lot of the COVID-specific hardship funds were made open to international students as well. That's no longer the case. But I think that as well as, and I believe, the international students should be able to come here, should be able to study for free, should be able to receive the same financial support as other students. We're not currently in that situation. But what we can do is we can also look at the other tools and the other mechanisms that the Scottish Government can do to bring down the cost of living for all students in other ways. So, for example, through rent controls, for instance, bringing down the cost of purpose-built student accommodation, through schemes like the free bus travel for under 22s, if that was extended to all students, for example, that would have a huge benefit for home students and international students alike. So I think that there are other things that we can look at in terms of the support that can be given to all students, but international students are really struggling financially at the moment. That puts off a lot of students from coming and studying here in the first place, but it also means that those who are coming and paying huge extortionate fees to do so getting sold a raw deal.
Thank you.
Press my button, sorry. Thank you very much. Thanks for your time this morning. It's been a very interesting session, and that's the public part of today's meeting now at an end. We'll consider our final agenda item in private, so I now suspend the meeting. Thank you very much.